Hello and welcome to this presentation from the Urban Penguin. My name is Andrew Mallett and today we're going to look at LPI Level 1 and managing swap space on our Linux server. As always, you can find these videos on theurbanpenguin.com. If you're on Twitter, you can follow me at theurbanpenguin, and on Facebook you'll be able to find and like my page as The Urban Penguin. So we're working on the command line of my Red Hat Enterprise Linux server. When you're planning for your Linux server or Linux desktop, one of the considerations is how much swap space is going to be used. As far as swap space, what we mean by that is virtual memory. So when the RAM, the real memory on the system, starts to fill up, we can swap out elements of that RAM, what's stored in the random access memory, and have it stored on disk. In Linux, swap can be stored in a partition or in a file. In other operating systems, it may just be a file, but in Linux it is the normal during the installation that we create a partition that is dedicated with a file system specific to swap. If we look at the command swapon, so if I run the command swapon and then minus s, it's going to display my swap files, and we can see that we're using devmapper 1, so this probably is just set up as an LVM partition. We can see the size of it, so it's about 1.5 gig. And currently we're not using any of the virtual memory, and it's set to a priority of 1. Okay, and some of these parameters that we'll come back to. So swapon is a command that you might expect is used to enable swap once we've created the swap space. Swapoff would turn it off, but using the option minus s, we can display the swap that we have. It's really reading from the file cat slash proc slash, and so you can see it just becomes a simple command, as many commands in Linux are. They're retrieving information from files, so the file /proc/swap contains the swap file information. If we look at my disk structure, so I've got fdisk minus l, I've got a disk here, SDB, so my second disk is just about a gig and it doesn't have any partitions on at the moment. So if I go and look at partitioning up the disk, are we going to run the command fdisk and then /dev/sdb and then hit enter? We can hit P to print and we can see that indeed there are no partitions. And then we can create new partition, and we can choose a primary partition, so we can have a maximum of 4 primary partitions. We're going to start at cylinder 1, and then we can go through and specify where to go through. So yeah, we're going to accept the default start, and then plus, and we'll have, let's say, we don't need a lot of space, I'm just going to put 100 meg. If I print that out again, it's been set up as a standard Linux partition. We need to make sure this is for swap. So we change the type using the key T, and then I put it to type 82. So we can see now that we've changed the type of the partition to Linux swap, and again I can print it out with P, and we can see indeed that we've changed the partition type for SDB1 through to type 82. So we write the information back, and now if I list that, so we can double check that it's stored, fdisk minus l /dev/sdb1, sdb, and then we can see that we've got the partition created of type 82. Now, having a partition, that in itself is not swap space. In the same way, if I create an ordinary file system, that is not a file system. It has to be formatted. and we format partitions with the muck command. But for a swap, we use muck. Instead of muckfs, we use mkswap. /dev/stb1. This is writing to that partition, so if you're doing this on your own machines, just double check you've got the correct partition in there. We can see then, once it formats it with swap space, it's a file system that is dedicated to virtual memory. We can see that we haven't put a label on, but we could assign a label if we want. All file systems have their own unique identifier, and that's the unique identifier. If we want to use this as our swap space, we can then run the command swap on and then /dev/stb1. Now, of course, when I look at my free memory, so if I run free minus m, so it shows in megabytes, we can see my swap space has gone up from 1600 through to 1700. If we run the command swap off /dev/stb1, run the free command again, we can see we've gone back to 1639. If we want to ensure that the swap space is used, then we can put it into our fs tab file. But before we go that far, let's just clear the screen. So Control L will clear my screen if I'm using the bash shell. And let's take a look once we have mounted it. So swap on /dev/stb1. And then run the command swap on minus s. So we can see now that we've got two swap spaces in use, and then we've got a priority of -1 and -2. The priority controls which swap space is going to be used first. The higher the number, the higher the priority, and that partition will be used first. So in my case, dev mapper is going to be used as the swap space before we use the second drive. The higher the number, the higher the priority. The swap space with the highest priority is used first. If we don't set a priority, then the priority is in the order that the swap space is mounted. Hence we get -1 and -2. -2 being the lowest priority out of the two that we've got here. It was the last that was mounted. If I turn it off, so swap off /dev/stb1, and then we're going to mount it again, but this time if we use, say, -p10, hit the enter key, now look at our swap summary, we can see that SDB now has the highest priority. So when the kernel sees that it needs to start swapping out, it will swap out to SDB1 before it goes to the dev mapper. So we can control where the virtual memory is used. Now, of course, if we want our file systems to be persistent, they have to be written through to a configuration file. And our swap files are mounted through the fs tab file, /etc/fs-tab. So we'll just jump in and edit that file, /etc/fs-tab. I'm running this as root, but you could get a root prompt or you could run it through sudo, and you could use a text editor of your own choice. So we can see this is where our current file system is mounted, or swap file system is mounted. So it's the LVM. It's mounted to virtual memory, or swap. The file system is of type swap. We've got a rather lazy entry. It was put in by the installation defaults. If we go through and change the defaults here, so I'm just moving across, and we'll run a control clear word, and we'll have really the options that we want is to say this is swap that we are mounting, and then we'll put a priority, so PRI equals 5. I want to put in a new entry for /dev/sdb1. But if I put an entry in like this, /dev/sdb1, it's not 100% reliable because the disks may not be detected 100% reliably as SDB. If another disk happens to go up the disk controller bus order in a higher number, then that could become SDB and this disk would become SDC. So to avoid errors like that, we could use something as they've done here for the boot file system using the UUID. And I'm sure you remember that when we created the file system with mkswap, it showed me the UUID. Can you remember what it was? You disappoint me. You should be able to remember that. But if you can't remember it, and of course you're not going to know that, Vi will come to the rescue. If I get into my normal command mode, so we go escape and then colon, you can see at the bottom of the screen we've got the colon, and then we read in exclamation mark, so the output of the command, and the command is block ID, BLK ID, and we read in /dev/sdb1. So we can see now that it's given me the entry that I want. We can then tidy it up a little bit. So with that in place, we can then run through insert, and then we want to say that it's mounting to swap. It's the swap file system, so the type of file systems. And again, we're using the mount options. And with this one, I'd like it to be used ahead of my root file system, or the same disk that my root file system is on. So I put it as a higher priority. And we don't need it for the dump backup system, and we don't need it to be checked on boot. We can then save all of that. I run the command swapoff -a. It's going to turn off all of my swap file systems, so swapon -s. And then if I go swapon -a, it's going to read everything from the FS tab. And now when we look at the summary, we can see that we have both the dev mapper and the SDB1 mounted with the correct priorities. So we've been able to create the swap space, utilize the swap space, and make sure that it is mounted permanently through the FS tab. We've controlled access through the priority. As far as planning is concerned, a lot depends how much physical RAM that you have. If we've got, say, 2 GB of physical RAM or less, then the normal recommendations are about 1.5 to 2 times the amount of virtual RAM to match the physical RAM. Whereas if I've got something like 8 GB of RAM, well, I don't really need 16 GB of virtual RAM. So we can get progressively smaller depending on how much physical RAM that we have. But very much is going to be to see how much is being used on your own system. We can control access to virtual memory, Again, if we go through and look at the free minus m command, we've added in this extra swap space. So we went from 1.6 through to 1.7 gig, but we're still not using any. And that's controlled through a kernel parameter. If I cat out /proc/sys/vm/swappiness, currently my value is 30. The value can be from 0 through to 100. The lower the value, the less likely swap is to be used. If I set it to 0, we're only going to use the swap files really to avoid an out-of-memory situation. Whereas we set it to 100, swap file usage is going to be more aggressive. So if I did something like this, echo 100 and send that through to my last argument. The last argument was the name of the file. And of course, if we run the cat command, so exclamation mark cat is just running the last command that began with cat, we're reading the value back. Of course, yeah, I've not really run anything at the moment, so there's nothing that's going to really use any more memory than I'm currently running. But if I go through and start opening up, let's say, the Nautilus file browser, and then start looking through the file system, we'll just close that out. Still don't have anything really that uses too much memory on this system, but if we look at free minus m now, yeah, we really still can't force this to use any more. Let me just go through. This will probably kick in something. So if I open up the Firefox browser, so again, then just moving that into somewhere that you can see. Just happen to be using a Red Hat machine at the moment, so of course the browser is pointing through to Red Hat. Let's just close, well, let's leave that open and now look at free. See, we've just got too much memory. So we can see that we've gone from our physical RAM, we've gone down from 877 to 689. But we're going to have to start kicking off some Java applications so we start using some of the swap values. But yeah, we have that swappiness file that can be used to control the aggressiveness of how much the kernel will swap memory. 100 will force virtual memory to be used more frequently. The lower value that we set, so setting it to 0, is really much going to disable swap, and it's only used to avoid out-of-memory situations. The last thing that we really need to consider is if you don't have any partition space available and no extra drives to be able to use virtual memory, you can create swap files. So swap files then exist in a normal file system. We still format the file, but that file itself sits on top of a traditional Linux file systems. So I can create my file by using the dd command, so just the little disk imager. And my input file equals /dev/0. My output file equals, and we'll just send it to the temp directory at the moment, so we'll go temp swap. We'll write 10, so count equals 10. We'll write 10 blocks, and then our block size will be 10 meg. So roughly 100 meg that we're writing. Once we're ready with that command, I'll hit enter. So we write our 100 meg through to that file. So literally that's just written a whole load of zeros through to the file /temp/swap. We format it, so mkswap/temp/swap. Again, you can see we've got the UUID, and then we can run the swapon command. We can set the priority, so I might have this as a priority of 1/dev. So remember, the lower the priority, the least likely it is to be used. Instead of /dev, it's going to be /temp/swap. Once we're ready with that, just warning me that we probably should change the permissions. So that's a good idea, but for the moment I'll leave it as it is. And then when we go through now and run swap on, we can see now that we've got the partitions and now we've got a swap file. Swap file is used with priority of 1, and we can see we've got higher priorities on both our other areas. Okay, it's just not formatting nicely, so of course we've got to move all of this across to be able to read it correctly, but you get the idea. Again, I can put this permanent by putting it into my FS tab or just use it when I need it. But there you go, we've looked at planning our swap file and using and managing swap on a Linux machine. The commands are pretty much the same across all Linux distributions, so we happen to be using Red Hat here, but it would be the same on your Ubuntu, SUSE, Debian servers. Thank you very much for watching, and I do hope to see you back on the Urban Penguin channel very soon.